I'm Michael Sparrow. I'm the chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management at the Mailman School of Public Health. And I'd like to welcome you all to the inaugural HPM holiday cooking class. In a minute, I'm going to introduce your holiday cooking host, Mark Bittman, along with several of our students who will be cooking alongside Mark tonight. First, I want to just briefly acknowledge that this has been a long and hard year, especially for those of us who suffered personal losses due to the virus. It's been a year in which we've used Zoom to conduct nearly all of our classes, our graduation ceremonies, our meetings, our research projects, and now it's a year in which we're going to have our holiday celebration via Zoom. We're not going to be able to have the traditional holiday party this year. And in that context, we were trying to think about how we could end the year by doing something interesting and different and fun. And at that point, a couple of our HPM staff, Becca Schoenfeld and Rebecca Sale, came up with the idea of a holiday cooking class, which was a really perfect idea, especially because we have on our HPM faculty the world-class chef, cookbook author, and food policy expert, Mark Bittman. Many of you know Mark from his 30 cookbooks, including the How to Cook Everything series, couple of which my wife uses regularly and I use sometimes. Others of you know Mark from his work as a food journalist and columnist, especially his many, many years writing for the New York Times. Still others of you know Mark as a true food policy expert who teaches a course each spring here in HPM on the food justice movement. What does it mean for public health? Mark is a colleague and a friend, and we're really lucky and grateful that he agreed to be our guide in cooking a delicious holiday dessert. Thanks for agreeing to do this, Mark. We're also really lucky here in HPM to have the HPM Mentor Program, which matches first-year students with second-year students to help ease the transition into the program and to help our new students take advantage of all Mailman has to offer. This year's leadership board is comprised of four second-year students, Saba Rawjani, Crystal Harris, Abby Malapali, and Sonika Kumar. We're grateful to all four of you, to each of you, for what you do to make our HPM community a better place. And tonight, we're also grateful that you've graciously agreed to cook alongside Mark. So to everybody listening, to the four of you, to Mark, have some fun. Learn a new dish, and here's hoping that each and every one of us has a better and happier year ahead, filled with lots of good food and lots of good times. So Mark, I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Thank you, Michael. That was really, really nice. I appreciate it. And welcome all to the first annual Mailman Holiday Cook-Along. We chose, we looked at a bunch of recipes. We wanted to do something simple, unusual, quick, interesting. And so we chose an old favorite of mine, which is chocolate pudding made with tofu. So it is non-dairy chocolate pudding. And it is, the thing about it is that it is kind of mind-blowing because it's really great and really easy and surprising. No one guesses the ingredients when you serve this to them. So you've all of you who are cooking have seen the recipe, and all of you who are actually cooking presumably are prepared. So I just want to run through the ingredients you should have. If there's anything you need to scurry and get, now would be your chance. You should have either 3/4 cup of sugar syrup or 3/4 cup of sugar and 3/4 cup of water. And if it's the latter that you have, the 3/4 cup of sugar and the 3/4 cup of water, why don't you go ahead and melt those together? So the thing to do is either boil the water separately and pour it into the sugar and stir, or you could do what I did, and that is combine the sugar and the water in a big measuring cup. You can obviously even measure right in there. Put that in the microwave, and at about a minute, the water will be hot enough to dissolve the sugar, maybe a minute and a half, depending on the power of your microwave. So that's kind of the first order of business, because we want that. We don't want anything to be too hot. So that's going to need to cool off a little bit before we get going. The second ingredient that needs to be done early on is about a half a pound of chocolate chips, or shaved chocolate, or chocolate pieces, or whatever. Good chocolate, semi-sweet or bittersweet. I mean, I say good chocolate, but in fact, I'm using whatever you call them, Toll House chocolate chip, Nestle's chocolate chips. So let's say reasonably halfway decent chocolate. That also needs to be melted. Now, the classic way to, there are three ways to melt chocolate. One is over the lowest possible flame, stirring really a lot. Another is over a double boiler, which means a pot with hot water in it, boiling water or simmering water, with a bowl that fits into that pot. That's a more controlled heat, takes longer, but it's safer because chocolate can burn. And then you don't have to stir quite as much. The easiest way to do this, the easiest way to melt chocolate, and that this is what I just did, is put it in a bowl. Again, use a microwave. Put it in a bowl and microwave at about 15 or 20 second intervals. And then do it for 15 or 20 seconds. Take the bowl out. Stir it with a rubber spatula. Do it for another 15 or 20 seconds. Stir with a rubber spatula. And before it's completely melted, when there are still a few little lumps in there, stop, keep stirring, and the residual heat of the chocolate that's melted will melt the remaining bits. I'm going to show you what mine looks like. That took me a minute and 15 seconds. So you want that to cool also. So I did this in the 5 minutes or so right before we went online, and this is lukewarm now. It's not hot at all. My sugar syrup is also just lukewarm. So the other couple of things you need are silken tofu. I often buy it in these, whatever we call them, vacuum sealed boxes, because they keep forever, and silken tofu can be hard to find. But you can, if you find it fresh in the refrigerator, that's great.
We have a question actually related to the tofu. Esther is asking, can you substitute yogurt for silk tofu?
I doubt it, but you can try and see what happens. But it doesn't ring true to me. Sour cream might work, but I've never tried it. If it works, you've tried it and it works, let me know. So you need about a pound of silken tofu, and then a teaspoon of vanilla, a teaspoon of cinnamon, about a teaspoon of chili powder, very mild chili powder, just for a little bit of kick, and maybe the tiniest pinch of salt.
We have another question coming in from Lauren. She says, can we substitute firm tofu?
It won't work. This is really easy, but you got to go out of your way to use silken tofu. Okay. This is not, any of you who know my work know that I'm like constantly saying you can do this instead of that, you can do that instead of this. This is one of those recipes where you got to follow the recipe, but it's really easy. So are there other questions right now, or should I plunge ahead?
Go ahead. I will let you know if there are any other questions.
Okay, good. Thank you, Saba. I'm gonna take the camera and try to work one-handed and follow myself at the same time. So I think the thing that you want here is to put the chocolate in last, and otherwise it kind of doesn't matter. I want you all to appreciate this incredibly beautiful osterizer, this is not the blender I grew up with, but this is very much like the blender I grew up with. And they were called osterizers. So anyway, sugar syrup, vanilla, cinnamon, as I said. I'm skipping the chili powder because ultimately I'm going to serve this to a kid and I don't want objections. The tofu.
We've got a question from Andrea.
I'm listening.
Curious to know, what's your favorite brand / type of baking chocolate?
Well, I use, it's just a question in a way of what's available and how lavishly I feel like spending. I think that Kaibo and Valrhona, which are pretty easy to find, and are in the sort of 60%, 60 to 70% chocolate range, and are pretty good. There's obviously increasing amounts of I don't know if you'd call it craft chocolate, artisanal chocolate, but chocolate that's really well sourced, responsibly sourced, and beautifully made. And if you want to go down that route, I mean, my favorite of those is Dandelion. It's out of San Francisco. But it's really another league that's really eating chocolate. It's almost too good to cook with.
Okay. And
so, go ahead.
Sorry, actually, a few questions. So Catherine's asking, do you drain the tofu?
I did. It's a really good question. But I don't think it mattered much. Not a lot came out of it. So, it's funny, I haven't made this recipe in quite a while. And the instructions certainly don't say to drain the tofu. And I know that the recipe works because I would be embarrassed if it didn't. There's not a lot of liquid in there and I certainly don't drain it aggressively, but I did leave it in a colander for half an hour or so. But as I said, not much water came out.
All right. And if somebody has, well, can we use beaters if we don't have a blender?
Yes, I think you can. This blender wasn't working. I mean, this blender is literally the same age as me. And I was thinking, what am I going to do? And I thought that's exactly what I thought I would do. So I think that would work.
Okay. And just out of curiosity, have you already put the chocolate in yet? Or have we missed?
No. Right here.
Okay, so the chocolate's
still going in now.
Great.
I just think the chocolate should go in last so it doesn't get caught, trapped in the bottom of the blender, which happens sometimes. And those of you who have more modern blenders, which I think is likely to be every one of you, you're going to have more room in your blender than this. This is particularly small blending bowl, but it'll be big enough for this. One of the reasons you could do this while the stuff is still hot, but anyone who's ever had a blender accident with hot stuff in it knows that that's the last thing you want to happen. So now you just blend, and just a couple of words of advice. Low speed pulse until the thing is going, and then you can let it rip. So you could probably see that there's a little bit of residue, tofu residue on the top here that's not getting blended in. It's not the most powerful blender in the world, obviously. But if any of you are having a similar issue, just take your rubber spatula and stir that in. And a couple more. Thank you.
So, Professor Bittman, what's your favorite dessert?
I'm quite partial to chipwiches when I make them at home. It's favorites. They're hard to do favorites because it kind of depends on your mood. This is really good though, so I'm excited about having this.
Or I guess, what's your favorite to make as well? That could be different from what your favorite dessert is to eat.
Well, I do like, and when it comes to desserts, I do like complicated stuff. So I don't know, I will make puff pastry once a year or so. I think one of my kids and I are going to make a Yule log, a bouche de Noël for over Christmas this year, which is like a 2-day project. So I do like doing that kind of stuff. Yes. So this is going to make at least 6 of these. Let's see.
And so are we supposed to add cocoa powder?
No, the recipe is just what we've gone through.
All right.
So the sugar syrup, the melted chocolate, the seasoning, cinnamon and chili powder, and the tiniest bit of salt. The tofu, obviously. That's it. I don't think I missed anything. And it has to... It will, look at this, 6 perfect servings. It has to firm up in the fridge. I'm back. More questions. I want to lick this thing now, of course.
Sebastian wants to, well, so Sebastian's asking, my kids want to know if you watch/like the British baking show.
I don't. That is, I don't not like it. I don't watch it. Maybe I would love it.
You would do really well on the British baking show.
Yeah, my accent might be a little off.
Are you still involved with Purple Carrot? We love it and thank you.
That's really interesting. No, I'm not. It was a really brief sojourn for me, but I'm glad that it's working out.
Can you actually expand on what Purple Carrot is for those who don't know?
It was a vegan meal kit. And honestly, I don't know, you know, a delivered meal kit. I don't know anything about what it's been doing for the last 5 years or so.
Okay. Someone's asked, you mentioned a podcast. Do you have one?
Well, we're working on one, but what I meant is that I seem to make appearances on them weekly, so I do a lot of them. We did just do a cooking teaching podcast with a company called Knowable, and if you look up Knowable and with my name, you'll find it, and it's I think it wound up being 6 parts, and it's food philosophy and cooking. And it was really, really well done.
So somebody's saying ours has turned out quite soupy. Is that okay?
Yeah, you're gonna put it in the refrigerator, it's gonna harden.
All right.
You can drink it soupy, but if you wanna eat it with a spoon, wait till it's cold. Yes, you can use white chocolate chips.
What is the nutritional content of this dessert?
Well, the nutritional I don't have a nutritional analysis on hand. So it is the sum of a pound of tofu, 3/4 of a cup of sugar, and 1/2 a pound of chocolate chips, whatever that works out to be. That's what it is. I'm not hawking this as health food, but, and it's not low fat. It's vegan, if anyone cares about that. But I'm just saying it's really good. It's really easy. It's really interesting.
Okay, and adding on to that white chocolate chip question, I know you said you could substitute with white chocolate chips, but then would you need to adjust the amount or would it be the same?
I think it's about the same. I think it would be about the same.
All right, awesome.
I mean, that would be very pretty. It would be striking. I think it's easier to get good dark chocolate than it is to get good white chocolate, but go for it. Let me know how it works.
to encourage our attendees, you can always just drop your questions in the Q&A or the chat. But I think we've actually answered all of them so far. And so how long are we going to put this in the fridge for? I guess to each
life. Well, I don't think I'm going to be able to eat mine tonight because I go to bed early. But I think an hour, certainly no more than two, and it'll be fine. Okay. Sort of depends on how hot it was to begin with, how small your containers are, and so on.
Do the ramekins need to be covered?
No.
Another question, do you have any favorite holiday foods, dishes from your family / childhood?
Well, I mean, it's the first night of Hanukkah, so, you know, you have to talk about potato pancakes. And that is, you know, to me, that's winter holidays, latkes. So, but, and perfect for tonight. I didn't have them tonight as it happens, but there you go.
Another really interesting question. I'm so sorry I missed this before. So for those of us who haven't had a chance to take your food policy class, what are some of the biggest concerns you have about the next 20 years?
Yeah, I don't think we're going to go there tonight. Let's save that for a separate conversation. That's an hour by itself, that question.
Yeah, it's a pretty loaded question, that's for sure.
Go back to this chocolate pudding skin question.
So how do you feel about pudding skin?
I mean, I love it to death. And I have to say, if there's a disadvantage to this, it's that it doesn't form that kind of skin. It stays creamy throughout. If you want that kind of skin, you have to go get Mighty Fine in a box and make that chocolate pudding. And that's the best skin. It's the worst chocolate pudding, but it's really good skin.
Okay. And we have another question. Can you freeze this?
I don't think I would. Okay. I haven't tried. I wouldn't recommend it.
And an update. Esther used Greek yogurt, and it doesn't taste too bad as of now.
Well, I just don't think it's going to get firm, but it might. So, Esther, email us or something and see what happens.
Okay. What is your go-to vegan hot chocolate?
I have not thought about, I mean, to me, the thing about hot chocolate is you want it really creamy. You could make this, in hot chocolate form, but somehow that's not as appealing to me as it is this way.
Okay. Can you give us a quick vegan whipped cream to put on top?
Cashew cream would be really good whipped and put on here. So I would, to do that, I would do kind of equal parts by weight, or maybe two parts water to one part raw cashews in a blender, chill that, strain it, and whip that, and you will get a really good whipped cream out of that.
Sounds fancy. I'm an alum and so sad I couldn't take your course. Have you found a change in interest with your recipe to move towards more vegan cooking?
Well, that move for me started 15 years ago, so it's kind of hard to say. Certainly there are more people interested in plant forward cooking than there were 15 years ago. Yeah, I don't think it's not a coincidence that I got into it, and it's not a coincidence that people have paid attention to that. So I guess the answer is yes.
Okay. I'm allergic to dairy, so I love this recipe. Do you have any other suggestions for easy dairy-free desserts?
I'd have to start looking at books. I'm not that good at thinking off the top of my head. The answer is yes, I have many, but we can, either one of us or both of us can look at some of my books to find them.
Okay. Which country, in your opinion, makes the best chocolate pudding?
I don't know. I don't have an answer to that. I mean, chocolate mousse, which I guess is French, is sort of the highest expression of chocolate pudding. But a lot of it depends on ingredients, and as we were talking about before, the kind of chocolate you're using.
Okay, so a couple of updates too. So the beaters worked really well. So
thank you. That's great. I'm really happy to hear that. That's great.
Yep. And another update, regular tofu worked nicely for us. So that's good.
That's good too. I'm really glad to hear that also.
And then we've got some fancy people who are going to use peppermint bark to garnish.
That's cool too. You will find, I mean, I know I said you have to follow the recipe here and you kind of do, but there are infinite ways you could flavor this. Black pepper, orange peel, chili, as we've said, nutmeg. I mean, there are a lot of different ways in which this could be seasoned. I love the cinnamon chili thing. But, you know, it's probably because when I made this first, I had been going to Mexico a lot, and I really liked that style of chocolate.
Okay, amazing. I added cardamom powder and cayenne. Delicious.
Awesome. Very adventurous of you. Fabulous.
Okay, so we definitely have some creative people
for sure
in the audience today. Absolutely. How's the leadership board doing? Sonica, Abby, Crystal.
I also bought regular tofu, but it seemed to have turned out just fine.
That's really good. I didn't think that would work.
I bought very firm tofu and only have beaters. So I did not attempt whatever that was going to be. So I will get back to you with my second attempt probably tomorrow.
Yeah, that I think would be tough.
Yeah, and I'm pleased with mine. I couldn't find it at Whole Foods or Trader Joe's, but I found like a random store that did have the silken tofu, and it's chilling in the fridge right now, but it did taste pretty good.
That package stuff, what do you call this kind of package? I can't remember. Anyway, this boxed package stuff is really good to have around because, you know, it keeps for 2 years or something. So then if you want to make this or any other tofu thing, you have it.
We have another question. What's your favorite cookie in New York City? So non-homemade. So I guess this is, what's your favorite place to get a cookie in New York City?
I never buy cookies in stores. I also haven't been in New York City in 9 months, so.
My mind immediately went to Insomnia or Levain's cookies. So that's where my head was at. But I guess when you can cook really well, you'll just make them at home, which I don't have the.
It is what we do.
Yeah. okay. And then another comment, Professor Thurman said, Mark, off topic, but your entries in New York Times book of cocktails are terrific. Thank you for the ad lib piece, especially on margaritas. Cheers.
Cheers.
All right. So is there anything else to add, Professor Bittman here?
I don't feel like Professor Bittman here. no, I hope you all enjoyed this. I'm going to go put mine in the refrigerator and see if I can hurry it along.
Amazing. And actually, there's one last question. What cocktail would pair well with this?
I don't think cocktail is the word. I think you drink port wine with this, actually.
Amazing. All right. Well, this has been a pleasure. It's been awesome to just watch the leadership board and Professor Bittman, you cooking and showing us how to do this. And to everybody who joined us today, thank you so, so, so much for being here. We're so grateful we can still come together as a community and share these experiences. And so thank you again for showing up. Actually, we're still getting some questions. One more question, Professor Bittman. How important is it for home cooks to own a double boiler?
Not,
okay.
You can always improvise one if you really need one. I don't think I've used one in 20 years though, so not important.
Amazing. Okay. So like I said, thank you again, everybody. Please have a very, very safe holiday. You know, hug your loved ones if you can. And I hope we all can continue to remain grateful. Just remember, take a picture of what you created and on Instagram tag at Columbia HPM. And you will be put into, a raffle to win a giveaway prize. So again, it's, at Columbia HPM on Instagram. Again, thank you so, so much, everyone. And have a very, very safe holiday.
Thanks, Saba. Great job. Thank you, everyone.
Take care.